you worry, what, you know, what are you going to do?
It can be bewildering for an individual to make the decision between which treatment to choose for yourself.
I had a radical prostatectomy, and I chose that because I didn't really have a lot of choices, although there were a number that were presented to me. That was presented as the gold standard sort of operation for someone of my age.
What appealed to me, being an engineer, I liked the idea that robotic was controlled by a machine.
I was more interested in quality of life rather than necessarily longevity.
I wanted to be sure that the treatment was final.
So I decided I'd rather have the whole of my prostate out and finish with. And I decided that, and away I went.
And I chose brachytherapy because my age, my weight, my I had a virulent form of the prostate cancer and other considerations, and I'm very pleased with the choice that I made.
I was clearly distressed about the concept of surgery.
The doing nothing wasn't an option. Radiotherapy wasn't an option because of the overheads, and brachytherapy wasn't because I felt that it was all a little strange. So surgery was the way I wanted to go, and robotic surgery because it was less invasive, the recovery times were much better, and the outcomes were likely to be better for me.
Well, my main concern before the treatment was living or dying or whatever it was.
That for me, the sex part was more important than the death part.
Surviving, I guess, that was the main concern.
I had the high dosage brachytherapy followed by external beam radiotherapy. I chose it because to me it gave the best chance of completely eliminating the carcinoma in the prostate and preventing a recurrence there or a recurrence anywhere else.
The thing that I'll never forget was being diagnosed with cancer. The fear of the future, the fear of the unknown. What did it mean for my family? What did it mean for me? And what I found as I went through that journey was that the more information I had, the more I could combat that fear and the more I could chart the way forward. Unfortunately, when I was diagnosed over 6 years ago, there wasn't much information around. I was lucky. I knew people. I got a second opinion. And through that second opinion, I made my decision. Sadly, many men don't have access to a second opinion, nor to the type of information they need to make informed decisions about their treatment. Men are fearful about the impact on their sex life. Men are fearful about the impact of the cancer in the short term and the long term. This DVD resource is power. Knowledge is power, and the information here will help you make the most informed decision you possibly can, not only for yourself, but for your family. Study it with them. We're all involved in this together. Everybody needs to know what they're facing. That's why this DVD is so powerful.
Prostate cancer in the last 20 years has undergone a veritable revolution. 20 years ago, it was a condition that old men died of, and now it's a condition that young men no longer need to fear. There are now a plethora of new treatment options in the management of localized prostate cancer. It can be bewildering for an individual to make the decision between which treatment to choose for yourself. So how do you choose? My aim with this documentary is to help you make that decision using information such as cure rates, side effects, and the factors that will influence your treatment to make your final decision as to which treatment option is right for you. So what are the treatment options? The treatment options are radical prostatectomy, and this can be done sparing the nerves, so-called nerve-sparing surgery, or not sparing the nerves, depending on the extent of tumour. It can also be done by keyhole surgery, and this is by the laparoscopic or robot-assisted laparoscopic route. And finally, it can even be done by the transperineal route, although this is now rare. Radiotherapy is also an option, and it can be delivered by external beam radiotherapy, low dose rate brachytherapy, high dose rate brachytherapy, conformal radiotherapy, and even in some very rare institutions, proton therapy. You could choose active surveillance where you actually don't treat the tumour but monitor it, hormone therapy, or some of the less tested therapies such as high intensity focused ultrasound.
I was just about to celebrate my 50th birthday when I was diagnosed with prostate cancer. Happy birthday to me. And I elected to have the open prostatectomy as the operation and the form of treatment.
Because if I'd had any other treatment, it would have been impossible to have any follow-up. So I wanted to be sure that the treatment was final.
Radical prostatectomy is the complete removal of the prostate and seminal vesicle aimed in curing prostate cancer in its localised state. This is a well-established procedure and has an excellent track record and has been going for at least 30 years. It's suitable for those people with a greater than 10 and preferably 15-year life expectancy with localised prostate cancer, where the cancer is indeed a threat to their life. The aim is to cure the patient of prostate cancer and give him the least number of side effects possible. We aim for what's called the trifecta, that is cure, urinary continence, and erection potency. So what techniques can one use to perform this surgery? One can do this by the open retropubic route, or by the laparoscopic route, or by the robot-assisted laparoscopic route. So how does one choose which of these techniques to use? You need to be aware of the experience of the surgeon and the institution, and you also need to be aware of the side effect profile of the surgeon. And finally, the most important thing is the experience of the surgeon. It's more important to have an experienced surgeon than the latest and greatest technique. When performing this surgery, one of the very common side effects are erection problems. This brings up the problem of being able to do what's called nerve sparing surgery, which is a technique to minimize the chance of long-term erection problems. What the surgeon has to do is protect the erection nerves, but still remove the cancer in its entirety. You clearly have to be selective about which patients to do this on, and the things that might influence the surgeon in his choice may be the extent of the tumour, and also his experience, and also some of the findings that he may find at the time of the operation. Nerve-sparing surgery performed by an expert surgeon can yield excellent recovery of erections with time. It often takes 12 to 24 months for those erections to recover and often requires sexual rehabilitation. So what are the results of nerve-sparing surgery in expert hands? It very much depends upon the age of the patient, what his erections are like before the procedure, how experienced the surgeon is at nerve preservation, and how long after the surgery one makes the assessment. The ideal situation is a young patient who was fully potent prior to the surgery performed by an expert surgeon. In this setting, one can expect up to 90% recovery of erection functioning within 12 to 24 months. Overall, nerve-sparing surgery in large series has resulted in approximately 50% of patients recovering a reasonably good degree of erection function. When discussing radical prostatectomy with your surgeon, it is important to discuss the different types of radical prostatectomy, such as robot-assisted radical prostatectomy or the more commonly used open radical prostatectomy. Even laparoscopic radical prostatectomy, although not as commonly performed, needs to be discussed. The advantage of the minimally invasive techniques, that is, the robot-assisted technique or laparoscopic technique, is the speedier recovery, the shorter time in hospital, and the lowered blood loss. There is even early indications that there may be some benefit in terms of continence and potency, but these are as yet unproven. The advantage of the open technique is that there is a lot of experienced surgeons who perform this technique, and therefore that may lead to better outcomes than a less experienced robotic surgeon. There is, however, a general trend worldwide, particularly in the United States, to robotic surgery. Almost 70% of cases are now done with that technique in the United States. So with modern surgery, what outcomes should you expect? You should expect a high cure rate and a low complication rate, fairly short stay in hospital, minimal blood loss, a low incontinence rate, and a reasonable rate of erection recovery. These are expectations no matter who's doing the surgery or what technique is being used. So how can you as a patient judge whether the results of a particular surgeon are adequate? What's the benchmark against which you measure your surgeon? You need to know what the surgeon's positive margin rate is, his continence rate, and his erection recovery rate is. So what is a positive margin? A positive margin is where the pathologist reports after the removal of the prostate that cancer is up to the edge. What does that mean? It means you may have left some behind. That's a bad thing, and the best results are where the surgeon has a low positive margin rate. A benchmark positive margin rate really should be less than 20% overall, and for cancers contained to the prostate, that is PT2 cancers, less than 10%. The other two outcomes that you can ask your surgeon about are his urinary control rate and his erection recovery rate. One should expect a very low chance of serious ongoing urinary control issues, and certainly less than 3% in modern series is a reasonable expectation. It is, however, common to have mild urinary problems in up to 10%. What about erection recovery? It's important to emphasize that it can take up to 2 or even 3 years for full erection recovery to occur, and full erection recovery may never fully recur. One should expect in good hands, with nerve sparing, up to 90% recovery in the under 50-year-old age group, and between 50 and 70% in the older age groups, depending on how many nerves are spared and depending on what the erections were like before the surgery. So ask your surgeon, what's his positive margin rate? What's his continency rate? What's his erection recovery rate? What technique he prefers, and what's his experience level? These things will help you decide whether this is the right surgeon for you.
I definitely would go down the same path by picking the robotic surgery, because I think it's given me the best opportunity of a cure, so to speak.
Modern day radical prostatectomy is a much safer procedure than 20 years ago. It's associated with less blood loss, a quicker convalescence, better urinary control, less sexual problems, and certainly is not the operation it used to be. What has been increasingly demonstrated in all the series is that radical prostatectomy must be performed by somebody with experience. We aim at what's called the trifecta, that is cure, continence and potency, and the more experienced the unit or surgeon, the more likely we will achieve the trifecta. Having said that, open radical prostatectomy still carries with it significant disadvantages, such as the speed of recovery and a not ideal recovery of sexual function, leading to other options such as robotic radical prostatectomy, which is less invasive, potentially improving outcomes. The benefits of robot-assisted radical prostatectomy are, firstly, a shorter stay in hospital, secondly, a quicker return to normal activities, thirdly, less blood loss, fourthly, better vision compared to the open or laparoscopic technique, and finally, better dexterity than both the open and laparoscopic route. In addition, it has the promise of improved urinary control rates and potency rates based on the most recent published series from experienced units. The technical advances that have led to this overall technology are many. The first thing is the three-dimensional 10 times magnification one gets to give excellent visualization. This is better than both open and laparoscopic surgery. The second advance is the ability to motion scale. This enables more degrees of movement of the human hand, allowing you to perform fine movements in a very confined space. The third advantage is the eradication of any tremor by computer technology. And the final advantage is the ability for this technology to be intuitive, meaning that motions with your hand are translated in the body to similar motions one would feel as though one were doing open surgery. This has a considerable advantage over standard laparoscopic surgery, which is very difficult to master and is what we call counterintuitive. So how does one do a robot-assisted radical prostatectomy? The patient is placed on the table under a general anaesthetic, and six small holes are placed through the abdominal cavity. The surgeon then connects the robot to these six small holes and then moves from the patient to his console. The assistant surgeon stands by the patient the whole time, and his function is to assist the main console surgeon in the performance of this operation. What does he do? He passes sutures, he sucks, he puts clips in, and so he's quite integral in the whole performance of the procedure. This is a two-man procedure. The surgeon then sits at the console and with his hands in special devices controls every movement that occurs within the body. Nothing happens without the surgeon moving. So this is called a master-slave situation, and although we use the word robot, it really isn't a robot, as robots perform tasks unaided. The surgeon then performs the operation of removing the prostate and seminal vesicles and then rejoining the bladder to the urethra, similar to the open operation. The advantages, however, are that it's like being a miniature person suspended inside the body and working with very, very fine instruments and being able to see extremely clearly and very dexterously. As well as that, there is an extra hole in the abdomen which allows an extra arm to be controlled by the surgeon, like having a second assistant hold things in a perfectly steady manner. Before the prostate is removed from the body, a join or an anastomosis is fashioned between the bladder and the urethra, and this is done very accurately using the highly sophisticated needle holders in a watertight technique. In short, robotic radical prostatectomy and the use of the Da Vinci machine offers several advantages over conventional laparoscopic and open surgery. Firstly, it allows fine instrumentation in a very confined space. Secondly, it allows 10 times magnification with 3D vision. Thirdly, it allows avoidance of any tremor. And finally, it allows maneuverability, which is greater than the human hand. Not everybody is suitable for robot-assisted surgery. If one does choose this, then certainly it has the advantages of a quicker recovery, as I've previously stated. However, there are some cases that are actually more difficult with robot-assisted surgery, such as people with extensive abdominal adhesions, which may make it harder to get down to the prostate. Also, people with very large prostates or a large projection of the prostate up into the bladder, called a middle lobe, can make this procedure particularly difficult. And finally, patients who have very extensive cancers who need wide dissection of the lymph glands can be treated better at this stage with the open technique based on current results. The ideal case then for robot-assisted radical prostatectomy is a male who has a localized prostate cancer, who wishes a more speedy recovery, and whose cancer is not too extensive, and who is quite attracted to this technology. People who are obese and people who have previously had laparoscopic hernia repairs are ideally suited, for the obesity does not make this procedure harder, and nor does the laparoscopic hernia mesh, which indeed makes the open technique more difficult. So what are the results of robot-assisted radical prostatectomy? It really began in earnest in 2002 and has been increasing in use since that time. Almost 70% of radical prostatectomies in the United States are now performed using this technology. The results of open radical prostatectomy and robot-assisted radical prostatectomy are similar from the best units in the world with regard to the trifecta, that is cure, continence and potency. Indeed, some results suggest that continence and potency may actually be better with robot-assisted radical prostatectomy, but only after reasonable experience. Results of robot-assisted radical prostatectomy are equal to the best results of open radical prostatectomy, even from the most experienced units, as we stand in 2008. Some people would suggest that the continence, that is the return of urinary control, may even be better in robot-assisted radical prostatectomy series because of the excellent watertight seal. There is further more information to suggest that erection recovery may be quicker and more complete after robot-assisted radical prostatectomy because of the gentleness and accurate dissection that robot-assisted radical prostatectomy affords. These are early results at this stage, but highly encouraging. The cure rate of robot-assisted radical prostatectomy from reported international results are equal to the best reported results from open surgeons. I now offer robot-assisted radical prostatectomy as a regular option for all patients with localized prostate cancer. Robot-assisted radical prostatectomy is ideal for those patients wishing a speedier recovery and who want to return to normal activities quicker, as long as the cancer of the prostate is contained to the prostate. It's also quite suitable for people who are obese and people whose cancer is not too extensive. Almost half of the 300 radical prostatectomies a year that I now perform are performed using this technology. I anticipate that this will increase in percentage terms over the next year or two. However, one must never forget that the trifecta, that is cure, continence and potency, are the most important aims when deciding on a treatment. I always consider this before which technology to use to ensure that we get the best outcomes for all the patients making their final choice. Having said that, robot-assisted radical prostatectomy is now an established option for people with localized prostate cancer, and it certainly delivers on the speedier recovery as with all minimally invasive treatments. In conclusion, robot-assisted radical prostatectomy is here to stay. It adds a useful addition to our armamentarium for pelvic surgery, and it is anticipated that this will account for over 50 and possibly 80% of all radical prostatectomies in Australia within 2 years. Radiotherapy is the delivery of ionizing radiation to an organ such as the prostate in the aim of killing the cancer cells and trying to spare the natural cells. It comes in various forms. The standard treatment is called external beam radiotherapy, and this uses machinery to give small doses of radiation therapy over a 6 to 8 week period delivered to the prostate to maximize the chance of killing the cancer. As the machinery's improved, there have been developments called conformal radiotherapy, which make it more targeted, and ultimately image-modulated conformal radiotherapy, or IMRT, which is extremely focused and extremely accurate. Modern machinery have made the side effects of radiotherapy less common, and we now realize that the dosage required to eradicate some cancers needs to be higher than we originally thought. Other forms of radiotherapy include brachytherapy, which is the slow delivery of radiation therapy to the prostate, and this can be done by low dose rate brachytherapy or seed therapy, and also by high dose rate brachytherapy using rods and iridium wires. Finally, there are other forms of radiotherapy less commonly used, such as proton therapy, radiosurgery, such as the use of the cyberknife, and tomotherapy. These are much less commonly used in Australia and even internationally, and with a much shorter track record. The advantage of radiotherapy is its less invasive nature compared to surgery, and also the ability to treat a wider field without damaging all the organs in the area that you're treating. The disadvantages of radiation treatments are: one, the potential for increasing the risk of new cancers 15 to 20 years down the track, be it a small risk. Two, the decreased ability to have a second fallback therapy, which is easier with surgery. And three, the side effects peculiar to radiation therapy, in particular bowel side effects, because the bowel is so close to the prostate. Because of these concerns, radiation therapy is generally reserved more for older men and for people with more extensive cancers, often in combination with hormone treatment. It may also be used for those deemed unsuitable for surgery or people who refuse surgery. It's not ideal in patients with large prostates or severe urinary symptoms where the radiation may cause swelling, which will indeed aggravate those symptoms. Furthermore, it's not suitable for patients who've had previous radiotherapy or people who suffer a lot of bowel complaints, which of course the radiation may aggravate. The common side effects of radiation therapies are damage to the adjacent organs, such as the bowel or urinary tract, and this can lead to severe problems in the bowel in 2 to 3% of patients in more modern series. This is less common if you use brachytherapy compared to the external beam technique. The other common problem with radiation treatments are erection problems. This is more common with external beam radiation and less common with brachytherapy, that is the seed therapy. The other common side effect of radiation therapy is urinary problems, running to the toilet more frequently. This is particularly common after brachytherapy, and indeed in the long term may lead to scar tissue, leading to a condition called stricturing, and this occurs particularly after high dose rate brachytherapy, where there is a 2 to 3% incidence of this complication. The final complication relates to the bowel, and in the long term, this may lead to a smaller bowel capacity in about 20% of patients, leading to more frequent bowel actions and a 2 to 3% chance of severe bowel problems such as bleeding and fecal incontinence. This fortunately is rare with modern machinery, but it still occurs. What are the results of radiotherapy compared to surgery? Generally, most experts feel that the results are equal. However, recent literature would suggest that there is a slight advantage to surgery even after 10 years of follow-up for the more aggressive cancers. Again, the expertise of the unit and the sophistication of the machinery are important in the outcomes of this type of treatment. Hormone therapy is often used in conjunction with radiotherapy. It's been shown that with more aggressive cancers, that the use of hormone therapy, often for 1 to 3 years after the radiotherapy, can improve the chance of curing these more aggressive cancers. So what questions should you ask your radiotherapist? 1, what experience does he have? 2, what machinery does he have? 3, what's the likely cure rate and side effects in his hands for your cancer? And 4, what dosage does your cancer require?
I had the high dosage brachytherapy followed by external beam radiotherapy. I chose it because to me it gave the best chance of completely eliminating the carcinoma in the prostate and preventing a recurrence there or a recurrence anywhere else.
Another form of treatment, and again it's a radiotherapy type of treatment, is high dose rate brachytherapy, and this is usually used in combination with a shorter course of external beam radiotherapy. This treatment has been developed for patients who have more advanced cancer of the prostate. That is to say, a patient who has locally advanced cancer of the prostate.
The treatment is, to be honest, quite painful. The treatment, you have a large number of metallic rods inserted through the perineum into the prostate. and they stay in there for 3 days. And during that period, you have three treatments with intense radiotherapy being pumped into the prostate through the rods to kill off the cancer. That in itself is uncomfortable, but it gets very painful if the body is moved very much. And unfortunately, that has to be done, and you can get a picture in your own mind, I'm sure, of what it must feel like to have 25 odd rods stuck into your perineum, moving slightly. But after that, when they were removed after the third day, very little after effects at all.
For example, if the cancer is very extensive or very high grade, or in a position of the prostate which makes it difficult to fully eradicate with surgery, this makes high-dose rate brachytherapy ideal for those patients. So if your PSA is high, such as greater than 15 or 20, if your Gleason score is greater than 7, such as 8 to 10, or if the clinical stage suggests it's a T3 tumour, in other words, outside of the prostate, you may well be suitable for this form of therapy. The other thing to consider is what your own personal priorities are. If potency is a priority and you have one of these extensive tumours, you may choose conformal radiotherapy with high dose rate brachytherapy over non-nerve sparing surgery, because the potency recovery is better with high dose rate brachytherapy compared to non-nerve sparing surgery. So that's another factor to consider. And finally, there are some people where surgery is very difficult, such as extreme obesity or local problems such as a fractured pelvis. And in these patients, it may be better to go with high dose rate brachytherapy than with surgery. With all forms of radiotherapy, one needs to be reminded that after 15 to 20 years, there is a slight increase in risk of second cancers in organs which are near the prostate, such as the rectum and the bladder. If you have a very long life expectancy, such as if you're in your 40s or early 50s, this would be a factor that you may take into consideration when deciding which treatment to undergo. In general terms, radiotherapy, and for the matter of this discussion, high dose rate brachytherapy, is generally reserved for a slightly older age group compared to surgery, because the fallback position after radiotherapy is not as easy as the fallback position after surgery. Let me give you an example. If surgery fails and the cancer comes back locally, you can always still offer radiotherapy to the bed of the prostate. Whereas if radiotherapy fails, options are very, very limited. So the younger you are, the more likely you are to go a surgical approach, because it leaves your options open. And often a 45-year-old man may have a 30 or 40-year life expectancy, and he wants to keep his options open for the long term. This may not apply to a 65-year-old man, where he simply wants to have the treatment most likely to eradicate the tumour in one go. When considering high dose rate brachytherapy, it's also very important to consider your age. You must always remember that the younger you are, the more likely you are to choose surgery, not high dose rate brachytherapy, because surgery is regarded as the gold standard and has stood the test of time much longer than any of the radiotherapy options. When talking about high dose rate brachytherapy, it's important to realise that this involves 2 days in hospital where wires are placed into the prostate to ensure that there's local treatment to the prostate, and you will be bedbound during this time. After the brachytherapy, you wait 2 weeks and then 4.5 weeks of daily radiotherapy is administered to the prostate. This completes your treatment, and this gives you a very high dose of radiotherapy to the prostate capable of eradicating even the worst cancers. Another form of treatment, and it's a form of radiation therapy, is brachytherapy. There are two forms of brachytherapy. The first one is seed therapy. Seed therapy is the insertion of radioactive seeds into the prostate in an attempt to destroy the prostate with radiation using radioactive iodine. In some countries in the world, they use radioactive palladium.
I had the seeds day before Melbourne Cup in 04, and I had no trouble whatsoever, and my PSA just kept coming down.
Seed therapy is a minimally invasive treatment that is done virtually as a day-only procedure, and it's meant for patients who have a very small, fairly non-aggressive cancer. Now, how do we judge that? It should be a Gleason 7 or 6 tumour. Not too many of the biopsies should be positive. And the prostate size should be under 45 cubic centimetres. As well as this, patients ideally suited to this are people who have minimal urinary symptoms. The big advantage is that it is clearly less invasive. The other advantage is that it has the lowest chance of sexual side effects compared to all the other therapies.
The main concerns before the treatment were the possibility that the sexual part of my life might be damaged, destroyed, or compromised, and I was particularly worried about that. And all the research that I had done, everything I'd read, pointed to the fact that brachytherapy seemed to offer the best shot at preserving sexual function. And because I was concerned about that, that's the way I ultimately decided to go.
It's not for everybody, it's only for those people with the right tumour and the right prostate and also the right age. The information we have on brachytherapy only spans 15 years. So if you have a greater than 15 year life expectancy, there's no guarantee it will go the distance. So it's really meant for people 60 years of age or over, and with a bit of a stretch, maybe 55 years of age, if sexual priorities are a very major factor. Remember, however, that if it fails, subsequent surgery can be made quite difficult, and you need to be aware of that at the same time. Hormone therapy is another treatment less commonly used for localized prostate cancer. Generally, it's reserved for patients with more advanced cancers. However, there are two settings in which it is used for locally advanced or localized prostate cancer. Firstly, in very old men as a less invasive treatment, and secondly, in conjunction with radiotherapy for more locally advanced cancers. So what is hormone therapy? Hormone therapy is the use of drugs to get rid of testosterone or the effect of testosterone in the male body. This is the food of prostate cancer, and by getting rid of it, you start killing off many of the cells and often put this cancer into a remission. So what are the common drugs used to control testosterone? Firstly, there are injections, the common ones being Zoladex, Lucrin, and Eligard, and these block the production of the pituitary hormone that stimulates testosterone. The second group are tablets, which block the effect of testosterone. Common ones here are Cosudex, Flutamide, Andrecur, and even Anandron. So the ideal patient for hormone therapy is a very old gentleman, perhaps over 80, who has localized prostate cancer, which is progressing too rapidly, which needs to be controlled. This often is controlled by intermittent pulses of hormone treatment, such as 1 year on, and then a period off the treatment. The other group of men who benefit from hormone therapy are people with locally advanced cancers where they've had radiation therapy at an adequate dose, often with hormone therapy for 1 to 3 years after that treatment. These are often patients who have cancers which are incurable by surgery alone. So what are the common side effects of hormone therapy as a group? Firstly, it can cause tiredness. Secondly, hot flushes. Thirdly, loss of libido or sex drive. It can cause mood swings, and it can also cause osteoporosis. All these can be minimized by attention to diet, exercise, sometimes medications, for example, for osteoporosis. And anticipating these problems is the most important part of preventing them. The final treatment that is worth mentioning is cryotherapy. This is freezing of the prostate in the aim of destroying the prostate and is aimed at also curing prostate cancer. It's a much less tested procedure, and very few units in the world have sufficient experience and expertise to give consistently good results. Having said that, in certain units with very great expertise, there has been some reasonable results for localized prostate cancer. However, it's not readily available in Australia, although there are one or two units who do use this technique in select patients unsuitable for surgery or radiotherapy. There is one other group of patients who are also suitable for cryotherapy and indeed also for high intensity focused ultrasound, and that is in patients who have failed radiotherapy. This is a very unique group of patients, and unfortunately, although it is a group of patients worthy of treating, the side effect profile is very high, and one must balance that against the potential benefits.
I was diagnosed with prostate cancer in late 2003, and it was a low-grade cancer. I was given advice that a radical prostatectomy would be appropriate. However, I was concerned about that and I elected not to do that.
Sometimes patients have cancers which are not destined to cause them any harm, even in the long term.
I'm in the process of what is referred to as watchful waiting, whereby I have regular checkups every 6 months and I have a biopsy every 2 years.
Patients are monitored regularly to find out if their cancer is progressing, and if it does, one then treats it.
The first biopsy was, of course, positive, which is how the cancer was determined. I had a second biopsy in the following year, in mid-2004, which again produced a positive result, but it was a very low-grade cancer, and it was in only one of 16 needles. Again, a low-grade result. And I continued then with the watchful waiting. I've had two subsequent biopsies, and indeed they've been quite invasive. They've been transperineal biopsies, and with at least 24 cores taken in each case. And in neither case have they found any cancerous material at all. So I believe that the watchful waiting process has been an appropriate process for me.
If you choose active surveillance, that doesn't mean you're never going to be treated. And indeed, one in three men end up requiring a treatment over a five-year period.
However, I'm very concerned about it. I have regular PSA checks and I'm due for another biopsy in 1 year. It's a condition which is always there. It doesn't leave your head. I'd like to say that the fact that I've had two clear biopsies recently has made my life comfortable and enjoyable again, and I don't have to worry about the prospect of cancer lurking in the background, but that's not the case.
Another ideal candidate may be a younger patient with a similar tumour who wishes to monitor the cancer for a period of time.
I was involved in a marriage which was coming to an end when I was first diagnosed. And I have found myself now with a new partner in my life. And I have a child now, a 6-month-old baby. And that is a great joy, a great source of joy in my life. I could never regret the decision that I've taken so far, which is to engage in watchful waiting.
And in fact, it's better to monitor it without regret than having a urgent procedure with regret. We call a Gleason 6 cancer a less aggressive cancer. And we also call patients with small cancers less aggressive. So a 73-year-old man with a small Gleason 6 cancer would be an ideal candidate. So if you choose active surveillance in the first instance, how do you know if you should get off the program? Well, you know it by the speed at which your PSA goes up, or the change in the cancer's nature at your next biopsy. These two factors are the critical factors in deciding whether to go for a definitive treatment such as surgery or radiotherapy and stopping the active surveillance. The other factor to consider is yourself. A lot of anxious people will become uncomfortable with the idea of living with even a small cancer, and they're unsuitable for this program.
I know that I have had a very low-grade cancer there. It's probably still there, and it's therefore incumbent upon me to keep a very active surveillance program.
I chose HIFU because it seemed to me to be a better option in my circumstance than the other less invasive form of brachytherapy. So whilst it was an expensive procedure, it seemed to offer for me the potential for a better quality of life, less invasive and minimal interruption to my normal business and social life.
This is a much newer treatment with a much shorter track record. Some people still regard it as experimental, but I prefer to regard it as an emerging treatment. Over 15,000 cases have been done worldwide, and it's increasingly being used in Europe and in other Asian countries, but as yet it is not approved for use in the United States. Two machines are available. One's called the Ablatherm and one's called the Sonablate. Results have now been published for up to 10 years. In Munich, where the longest results have been published, results are very good in appropriately selected patients. These patients are people with less aggressive and less extensive cancers, so-called low or intermediate risk cancers, where the PSA would be less than 15, the Gleason less than or equal to 7, and the clinical stage would appear to be contained. The treatment involves placing a probe in the rectum under anesthesia and heating the prostate to temperatures above 100 degrees centigrade. This focused ultrasound beam is repeated until the whole prostate is destroyed. After 3 months, when all the debris has passed, patients pass urine with a good flow, and one can then assess how successful the treatment has been by doing a PSA. Side effects of this treatment are common in the first 3 months, with difficulty passing urine, the passage of debris, which may cause a blockage temporarily, infections, or even scar tissue. Impotence is also relatively common. The advantages of this procedure is the fact that it is not radiation and therefore can be repeated, and it's one of the only therapies which can be repeated. As this treatment has only really been around for 10 years, this is generally reserved for older patients who are not suitable for surgery, the gold standard, or radiotherapy. They may be unsuitable because of age, general well-being, or even local conditions. These people, such as a 75-year-old man who may be unwell with a localized cancer, may be a good choice for this therapy. So when considering which treatment to choose, we've talked about all the treatment choices, but we've also talked about the cure rates and side effects. And finally, there are six critical factors that will influence you in which treatment to choose. These are the tumour factors, the prostate factors, the local factors, the institution factors, your own personal patient factors, and finally some other specific factors. When we talk about tumour factors, there are seven factors to consider: the PSA level, the Gleason score, the clinical stage, that is to say what the prostate cancer feels like, where the cancer is, at the apex or at the base, the extent of biopsy involvement, and the presence of cancer outside of the prostate. For example, with nerve-sparing surgery, you have to be confident that the cancer is contained, and one tends to only be confident if the cancer is small and not too aggressive and not too close to the nerve bundles. With seed therapy, for example, it's only really suitable for patients where the cancer is a Gleason 7 or less and the PSA is less than 10. With high dose rate brachytherapy, this is really ideal for patients where the PSA is higher, say around the 20 or 30 mark, where there is more extensive cancer in the biopsies and where the grade is higher. With high intensity focused ultrasound, it's only really suitable for Gleason 6 and 7 cancers in older age group patients where the cancer isn't too extensive. With active surveillance, this is only suitable for low volume cancers, Gleason 6, and maybe a couple of patients with Gleason 7. And finally, with hormone treatment, this is really suitable for people where the PSA is very high, maybe over 50, or where the cancer is very extensive, such as a clinical T4, or a very, very high volume cancer, unlikely to be cured by any of the local treatments. So clearly, all these factors influence what type of surgery, what type of treatment you should have. With robotic surgery, for example, to do an extensive lymph gland dissection can be quite difficult. And for very extensive cancers, you can't feel the cancer. So maybe that would be a reason for choosing open surgery compared to robotic surgery. So these are examples of how the tumour itself can influence your treatment. So the second group of factors are the prostate factors. What do I mean by this? I mean we need to consider the prostate size and the effect the prostate has on urinary symptoms. For example, if the prostate is causing severe difficulty in passing urine even before the treatment, you should avoid any radiotherapy treatment which may cause the prostate to swell, making urinary difficulty even worse. On the other hand, if the prostate is very large, it makes brachytherapy more difficult, such as seed therapy or high dose rate brachytherapy. If the prostate is full of calcium, it may make seed therapy and high intensity focused ultrasound very difficult. If there is a very big middle lobe or the prostate is very large, it may make robotic surgery very difficult. So you need to consider your prostate size and urinary difficulty prior to making a decision about which therapy to choose. The next group of factors to consider is what I call local factors. What I mean by local factors is what's happening around the pelvic area. For example, if the patient has had a previous fractured pelvis, it may make all surgery difficult. If the patient has a lot of abdominal adhesions, it may make laparoscopic or robotic surgery very difficult. If the patient has ulcerative colitis or any bowel condition, it may make radiotherapy unsafe. If the patient is extremely obese, it may make surgery very difficult. If the patient's had previous pelvic surgery, it may make future surgery very difficult. And if the patient has had previous radiotherapy, it may make radiotherapy unacceptably dangerous. So all the local factors have to be taken into consideration when choosing your treatment. Probably of all the group, this is the most important one in deciding which treatment you choose. I separate the patient factors into your priorities you take with regard to sexual function, bowel function, and urinary function, and your general health, and finally, what type of person you are. So first of all, the sexual function.
A big part of who I am, my identity, my ego, my self-esteem, is very closely linked to my physicality, physical prowess, fitness, strength, my athletic ability, and included in this, of course, is sexuality and sexual prowess. When I was told that I had a potentially life-threatening illness, what really scared me was the very real possibility that this could compromise, damage, and even cause me to lose the sexual part of my life. I've always loved women. Women have always been a very important part of my life, and the idea that I might never be able to make love to a woman again, I found very depressing.
The situation you find yourself in life at this current time with regard to your sexual function will have a big influence on your treatment. For example, if you've just recently remarried, you may choose the treatment with the lowest chance of sexual problems, even though it may not have the highest cure rate, such as low dose rate brachytherapy, if the tumour is appropriate. If you're not prepared to use sexual aids, you may choose a treatment with lower sexual side effects. The choice of nerve sparing surgery will obviously be extremely important if sexual function is a priority. Clearly, when one does nerve sparing surgery, if that's one's major priority, it may be necessary to seek out the surgeon with the best results at this type of surgery. If you have a small tumour unlikely to progress in the short term, and sexual function is a big factor, you may choose active surveillance in the short term to stabilise that relationship. So that's how sexual function can impact on your choice. How you feel about urinary incontinence can also affect your choice of treatment. If you have a particular fear about urinary incontinence, that may be the tipping stone that will stop you choosing surgery, even though the chance of that is low.
Radiation didn't appeal to me because of the long-term effects it would have on the tissue and organs in the close proximity of the prostate, namely impotence and so forth, and bowel function.
With radiotherapy, even though there's only a small chance of bowel side effects, if that is a patient's particular fear, that may be the tipping stone to avoiding all radiotherapy treatments. And if he still needs radiotherapy, he'll then go for a high dose rate brachytherapy as opposed to external beam to avoid damage to the bowel. And then there's general health. What's your life expectancy? What's your general health like? What's your age? These things can have a profound impact on your treatment choice. If you're old with a less than 10-year life expectancy and the cancer isn't too aggressive, then active surveillance may be the best treatment. Even if you're young and you're very unwell, active surveillance may still be the best treatment. On the other hand, if you're particularly unwell and unsuitable for any anaesthetic, you may need to choose radiotherapy options, external beam to be precise. And if you're on various medications, these may have an influence, such as warfarin, a blood thinner. This may be unsuitable for radiation treatment because if permanent bowel damage occurs and you're on this medication, this can lead to ongoing bleeding problems. If you're obese, it can make various forms of surgery more difficult, and it may make you choose a less invasive treatment to avoid post-operative problems.
And I chose brachytherapy because my age, my weight, I had a virulent form of the prostate cancer and other considerations, and I'm very pleased with the choice that I made.
The other factor within patient factors is what type of person you are. In my opinion, this is the thing that dictates which treatment you ultimately choose. Often it's the heart rather than the head that finally makes the decision as to which treatment you choose. Are you the I want it out type? In other words, you're not going to be happy unless the thing's out of your body, in which case you're clearly going to choose surgery.
Well, if I had to choose again, I would still choose the radical prostatectomy because I think it, with that type of complaint, I really feel that you're better to have it completely removed.
Are you the you're not going to touch me with a knife type? In which case, you're clearly not going to choose surgery, no matter what the facts stack up like. Are you the type of person who is intoxicated by new technology? I call that the technophile.
Definitely. Being an engineer, I like the idea when you compare, say, the laparoscopic, which is done purely by the surgeon, as compared to the robotic laparoscopic, which is controlled by the machine. I felt that I like the idea that the movements were intuitive rather than counterintuitive with laparoscopic. And I like the idea that it was the the movements were accurate and controlled by machine rather than by hands, and less prone for tremble and so forth. So that quite appealed to me, actually.
The person who's very keen to try new technologies such as robotic surgery or high-intensity focused ultrasound. Are you the punter who may try a new, relatively untested technology without as many runs on the board? Are you the conservative type, the type who will go with the gold standard, such as open surgery, to be sure of his results? Are you the natural therapy type, who would rather give some simple, less invasive natural therapy option a go before making a final decision? So, are you the type who wants to share the decision with the doctor, in which case you want second opinions, you want to discuss the treatment options, or are you the type that would rather find a good specialist and trust him and make him decide for you? Often this is cultural. You need to be honest with yourself, because you need to be comfortable with your decision and know why you're making the decision, and you need to know your own personality type. Are you the warrior? The warrior doesn't do well with active surveillance, because you're going to worry yourself into the grave rather than treat the cancer, even though it's not a particularly dangerous cancer. So that's how your own personality type will have a profound influence on which treatment you choose. Then there's another group of factors that I call other factors. And this is a potpourri of other factors that may influence choice. Things such as where you live, geography, may influence your choice. Such as if you're remote from centres that provide various specialist treatments, such as robotic surgery, that may not be an option for you. Family history may affect you. If you watched your father die a miserable death of prostate cancer, you're much more inclined to go with the gold standard with early aggressive surgery. The experience that you've had with a personal friend may influence you. For example, if a friend had a treatment and developed a severe complication such as urinary incontinence, it may frighten you off surgery, whereas if a friend got rectal problems after radiotherapy, you may shy away from that treatment. Unfortunately, finances can influence your choice. Some treatments are expensive. Proton therapy is very expensive. Treatments that aren't covered by Medicare, such as HIFU, are very expensive, and they may be the factors that influence your choice. Finally, how much time can you take off your work may also have an influence on your treatment decision. If you run your own farm and you can't be away and you can't delegate, the quickest treatment possible may be your treatment choice. And this is why some people choose, for example, robotic surgery, because the recovery is quicker. That's why some people choose brachytherapy or HIFU, because the recovery is quicker. So all those factors, what I call the potpourri group, may influence your choice. The sixth factor is what we call institution factors. What's an institution factor? Well, some institutions don't have some technologies, and some institutions have particular expertise in one treatment option. It's much better to go with what the institution's good at rather than what you want. So if an institution is good at robotic surgery, by all means choose it. If they're good at open surgery, by all means choose it. If they're good at IMCRT radiotherapy, by all means choose it. But don't choose the treatment that the institution isn't good at. One of the ways of trying to feel comfortable with your treatment choice is by having ideal cases for each treatment option. So nerve-sparing surgery is ideal for a younger, more conservative patient who wishes to have the gold standard, possibly with some urinary obstruction, with a high grade but low volume cancer with sexual priority is a major issue. Non-nerve sparing surgery is ideal for a patient who's under 60 with a higher volume, higher grade cancer where the nerves can't be preserved, particularly in a patient who's a more conservative, more surgically orientated patient, particularly where sexual function is not a priority. Conformal radiotherapy, or IMCRT, is ideal in a slightly older patient, perhaps older than 65 years of age, where other health issues may preclude surgery, where he has a significant cancer, and where he does not have urinary obstruction. Seed therapy is ideal in a slightly older patient, perhaps over 60, who has a low volume, low grade cancer, without an excessively large prostate, without too many urinary symptoms, and particularly where sexual function is a priority. It can be noted that obesity is not a contraindication to this treatment. High dose rate brachytherapy is ideal in patients over 60 where the cancer is much more extensive and less likely to be cured by surgery alone. In these patients, they shouldn't have too much in the way of urinary obstruction, and even if they have health issues such as heart problems or obesity, this is not a contraindication to its use. Active surveillance is ideal for older patients with small, less aggressive cancers. It's also suitable for younger patients with small, less aggressive cancers where sexual priority is an absolute priority, such as men in new relationships. It suits those people who are the natural therapy type, and it suits those people who are the I don't want it out type. So active surveillance is very good with the small cancers, with the understanding that they can fall back on a treatment. So I think these are the groups of people who are ideal for those. Robotic surgery is ideal for patients who are suitable for surgery, such as those who are suitable for any form of surgery. But in particular, those attracted to new technologies, to a faster recovery, and are prepared to undergo a treatment with perhaps a lesser track record. It's also ideal for patients without too large a prostate, without too many abdominal adhesions, and perhaps the patient who's more attracted to newer technology. It's not ideal for very extensive cancers, for in this group, there is some evidence that the open technique may give slightly better results. HIFU is ideal for those patients attracted to new technologies who are prepared to accept a less tested technology, particularly in the older age group with less extensive cancers. It's good for patients who have had a previous rebore or TUR of the prostate where the PSA is under 15 and who are prepared to accept unproven track records, yet a less invasive procedure. The next big factor to consider when making your choice is clearly the cure rate. How do you judge the cures of different treatments? We're very fortunate now that we have a thing called a nomogram that you can look up on the web to find out what the cure rate is from different institutions with different treatments. Michael Catan has developed nomograms to help one decide what the cure rate is of each treatment. For example, you can plug in your PSA, clinical stage, Gleason score, and number of positive biopsies and work out what your cure rate is with surgery, external beam radiotherapy, and brachytherapy. This may be a very useful tool to help you decide which way to go. Probably more importantly, you need to ask what the likely cure rate is of your individual institution that you're using. Although these other nomograms help you, your own individual institution is the critical one to look at.
No sort of after effects and everything. I'd sort of had the brachy seeds one day and I was going home the next day and I had no problems, sort of thing.
When discussing treatment options, another big section is the discussion of side effects. There are different side effects with each treatment option. With surgery, the big two side effects are urinary control issues and sexual issues. With modern surgery, in experienced hands, the side effects of incontinence, fortunately, are now very, very uncommon. Having said that, there can be a temporary period of incontinence, which may require expert physiotherapy assistance in the follow-up after surgery. This is no matter what type of surgery you have. It's also important to understand that sexual side effects are very common still, even after nerve-sparing surgery by the most experienced nerve-sparing surgeons. It is true that with experienced nerve-sparing surgeons, the chance of sexual recovery, that is, the chance of erections recovering, is much better these days. For example, if a 50-year-old man has careful nerve sparing surgery by an experienced surgeon, he can expect up to a 90% chance of erection recovery. Now, these are very different to the old days. He does, however, require a lot of support for the first 3 to 18 months while things recover. And this involves ideally a sexual health physician to aid him during that recovery phase. So what are the other sexual side effects of surgery? Well, most men say their penis length shortens. There's no fluid with ejaculation. Orgasm quality may change a little bit. So all these things need to be explained before the operation, ideally by a sexual health physician. It's best to ask your surgeon what the likelihood is of erection recovery in your particular circumstances. With radiotherapy, the common side effects are erection side effects and, to a very small degree these days, bowel side effects. Approximately 50% of all patients develop erection problems after radiotherapy. They do tend to occur over time, which is different to surgery, which occur immediately and then recover. With bowel side effects, fortunately, with modern technology, the chance of severe bowel problems, such as diarrhea, bleeding, mucus, and loss of control of the bowels, is very, very uncommon. It's now down to 2 to 3%, and with even more modern IMCRT, CyberKnife, proton therapy, these have even been minimized further. Brachytherapy seed therapy can also cause side effects. It has a lesser chance of causing sexual problems compared to ordinary radiotherapy, but it can cause sexual side effects, and some patients ultimately require Viagra-type medications to help them. The other side effect, particularly in the first 6 to 12 months, are urinary side effects. It can become quite frequent and urgent to go to the toilet, and indeed a small number of patients, particularly those with difficulty passing urine before the treatment, can find themselves in a casualty situation with a blockage. This is why we tend to steer patients with difficulty passing urine away from brachytherapy seed treatment. High-dose rate brachytherapy has a 50% chance of causing erection problems, but the beauty of it is that it avoids the damage to the bowel that external beam radiotherapy may cause. High-intensity focused ultrasound causes several side effects, particularly in the first 3 months. It may cause a urinary blockage due to the debris being passed, difficulty passing urine, and in the longer term, it may cause erection problems and incontinence. Severe incontinence is quite rare after HIFU, but mild incontinence occurs in 5 to 10% of patients, even in the long term after HIFU. Hormone therapy may also cause side effects, and indeed commonly does so. Hormone therapy is meant to drop the level of testosterone in your body, which effectively acts as the food of the prostate cancer. The common three side effects are loss of libido, and what I mean by that is loss of sex drive. It can cause mood swings. It can cause weight gain and hot flushes. As well as this, it can also lead to thinning of your bones if it's used for a long period of time, a condition known as osteoporosis. This is, however, now avoidable with calcium, vitamin D, and sometimes some extra treatments called bisphosphonates. With all these side effects, many of them are temporary, and many can be minimized by anticipating them beforehand. A sexual health physician can help speed up the recovery of sexual function. A physiotherapist can help speed up the recovery of urinary function. And a complementary therapy specialist can help speed up your overall recovery by empowering you to look after yourself. This may be simply spiritual, it may be with the use of exercise, a correct diet, some weight loss, or even complementary herbal or medication therapy. So with these other healthcare professionals working as a team with the urologist or radiation oncologist, your recovery will occur much quicker and you'll get back to normal at a much more rapid rate. So in conclusion, knowledge, education and understanding are critical to making your decision about your prostate cancer. This may include speaking to specialists, getting second opinions, researching information through reputable websites, and having things such as this DVD resource to help you make those decisions. It's very important to not rush your decision and speak to your friends, speak to your family, get the support of those people you trust around you. Getting second opinions may include getting a second opinion from a radiation specialist, an oncologist, another urologist, prior to making your decision. You need to tailor your treatment to what you're comfortable with and with the side effect profile and the cure rate that you're comfortable with. You need to understand all the treatment options prior to making a decision. Don't underestimate the value of family and friends. They can be helpful as a sounding board, emotional support, and to bounce off some of the information that you've received from professionals and health allied professionals. Remember to have realistic expectations, particularly when it comes to sexual function. The use of a sexual health physician can help you in that regard. Speak to your wife or your partner about realistic sexual expectations. Try and assess how that may impact your relationship prior to having the treatment. Form a team around you if you need to. Maybe you need a sexual health physician, maybe a psychologist, maybe your GP, maybe even a naturopath or a complementary medicine specialist. Put your team around you to make sure you feel supported through this journey. It's a difficult journey, and the more support you have from family, friends, professionals, and allied health professionals, the better the experience will be and the less chance you'll have regret at the end of the experience. So in summary, tailor your treatment to what you want for yourself in your personal circumstances for your prostate cancer, and use all the support you need from any source that you require so that you end up with an excellent outcome.